It is good to see this good number here today. We are thankful for your presence today and invite you to come back and be with us this evening and any time that you can be with us. We're grateful that you're here, and we hope that you'll stick around after services today and let us get to know you just a little bit better. I hate to start off with a mugshot like that. Some of you know who that is. That's Lou Holtz, probably best known for his time as the head coach at the University of Notre Dame, or maybe here in SEC country of South Carolina. But he started off his college coaching career gaining some notoriety at the University of Arkansas. And this picture was taken shortly before the 1978 Orange Bowl. At the beginning of the year of 1978, the end of the 77 football season, the Arkansas Razorbacks were set to play the Oklahoma Sooners in the Orange Bowl that year. Now, Oklahoma was number two in the country. Both Oklahoma and Arkansas had lost to the University of Texas, who was undefeated. And they were in line to win the national championship until they lost to the Joe Montana-led Notre Dame Fighting Irish in the Cotton Bowl that year. So the scene was set. The stage was there for the University of Oklahoma as the number two team in the country before the bowls began. They were in line, if they won this game, to win the national championship. And as it turned out, they were playing a vastly inferior Arkansas Razorback team. In fact, they were 18-point favorites. That's how much they were expected to win by, 18 points. And then of all things, Lou Holtz does something to increase Oklahoma's odds. Just a short time before the Orange Bowl was to be played, he suspended three of his very best players, and one of his all-conference performers was also ruled ineligible to play because of a bad injury he had. And so immediately the line for the Oklahoma Sooners being 18-point favorites hopped up to, they were now 24-point favorites. I mean, they were already etching Oklahoma Sooners on the national championship trophy. There was no way. And it's easy to see why. Besides the fact that Oklahoma was considered a better team to begin with, of the four players that were not going to get to play in the Orange Bowl for the Razorbacks, two of them accounted for 78% of the team's points scored that year. There was no way that Arkansas was going to win. In fact, Lou Holtz was put under pressure to go ahead and let those players that he had suspended for violating team rules go ahead and play, and he said, "We're not going to do it." And so all the talk was how that Arkansas didn't stand a chance. Oklahoma is your national champions this year. Until the night before the game was played, in the hotel room where the Arkansas Razorbacks were staying, Lou Holtz called all of his team into a meeting room there, and he sat them down and he said, "Fellas, all you've heard for the past week or so is all the reasons why that this team is no good. You've heard all the reasons why we don't have a chance to win this ball game. Now, I don't really know what to tell you. So I'm going to let you tell everyone the reasons why this is a good team." Silence across the room. Finally, a running back stood up and he said, "You know, I'm really proud of our offensive line this year. They've done a great job opening holes for us, and they've been very consistent in their play, and we wouldn't have gained a yard, and we wouldn't have scored a touchdown had it not been for the way that they blocked for us this year." And he sat down. Several minutes of silence went by, and finally one of the offensive linemen stood up, and he said, "Well, you know, I really want to brag on our defense, because there's been a lot of times that we left them in bad situations. We've turned the ball over, we couldn't move the ball, and they kept us in games by the way that they took care of their business on the field." Several minutes of silence passed. One of the defensive backs stood up and said, "You know, our returners have done a great job giving us great field position all year long. You know, we make them turn the ball over, make them punt, and first thing you know, they've turned the field over in the great job they've done returning punts." And that went on for several hours. as more people talked, more and more, and it got to the point to where it wasn't moments of silence in between, but rather as soon as one would quit speaking, four or five guys were jumping up and they'd have to take turns. You know, it's amazing what one man can inspire an underdog to do if he gets them to believe in each other, right? If an underdog trusts in each other, if an underdog works together, they can win, right? You know, the book of Nehemiah is a very similar story, I believe. Nehemiah is another one of those books, kind of like Ezra we talked about last week, that's not one we turn to a lot. If you'll open up your Bibles at the very center, just hold it up edgewise and just open it up right in the middle. You're probably going to be in Isaiah or Psalms or Proverbs, somewhere in that range. If you'll go back to your left, then you'll go through Psalms and Proverbs and Job and Esther, and then you'll hit Nehemiah. And it's a shame we don't spend more time in Ezra and Nehemiah and some of those Old Testament books, because they're rich with great lessons for us. Nehemiah lived in the same time frame that Ezra did. We talked a few weeks ago about what that time was, whenever the children of Israel were coming back to the land of Israel out of captivity. They were coming back to the promised land where they'd always wanted to be. All those years they'd been taken away. God had told them, there's going to be a time I'm going to forsake you, but then I'm going to bring you back and we're going to be reunited again. We're going to be married, is the language that he uses again. We're going to be together. And you're going to get to come back to this promised land. And that's what they cried for all those years they were in captivity. We just want to go back to that land that God promised Abraham and Isaac and Jacob that we get to live in. We want to go back to the place that we can worship God where He said, how He said. We want to go back and enjoy that relationship. Now, we realize we messed it up because of our idolatry. You know, we were going in other directions, but we want to come back to God. And God finally let them. And they got back to the place they were supposed to be. They were no longer in that land of idol worship, and that land of pagans, and that land that they didn't belong in. Now they're back where they're supposed to be. Now that relationship, you know, God did like He said, and He brought us back to Him. We're where we're supposed to be. We're in the relationship we're supposed to be. We're not surrounded by all those things that our past was involved in. And when they finally got there, some of them having never before set foot in the promised land, they just heard their grandparents and their parents talking about it. They finally got back there, and you know what they did? Whew. Boy, I'm glad to be back. And they relaxed. And they sat there. And then when people started arising, the Samaritans, for example, and began trying to pressure them to keep them from doing what they should, they withdrew that much more and said, well, at least we're where we're supposed to be, and at least the relationship's been restored, and we're not over there with them, and we're better off than them. So we may not be doing what we're supposed to, but at least we're here where we need to be. You know, I think that in the church, we could say that we're sometimes guilty of doing that same thing, right? We come out of the bondage of sin. We obey the gospel. We hear the good news about Jesus, and we believe that Jesus is the Son of God, and we choose to live for Him instead of self. That's repentance. And we confess before others our faith in Christ. We're baptized, immersed in water, and we're here with God's people. And the relationship has been restored, and we've got our checklist. You know, I believe, and I've been baptized, and we take the Lord's Supper on Sunday, and we worship the right way, and we try to have the right, and we're trying to do things the way the first century church did things, and we've got the checklist, and maybe I'm not out doing what I need to do, but at least I'm not like those people out there. And we kind of go, and relax. And in Nehemiah's day, it took Ezra and Nehemiah and those kind of guys to fire up the people and say, you know, it's not enough just to be in the right place. It's not enough just to be in the right relationship. We've got to do something. We've got to work. Our theme this year is a faith that stands. And so as we look at Nehemiah, the guy who inspired them to build the walls and was the very much the civil kind of leader, getting the organization of the land, the city, the people, the government back in order, the guy who was responsible for building, and you go through the book of Nehemiah and see how many times you can see build or work or building or builders or workers. Nehemiah, with all the things going on outside the city walls, with all the that was going on inside the what was left of the rubble of the walls, Nehemiah had a faith to stand and build. And what he inspired a people to do is what we need to inspire to do, or aspire to do. If you look in Nehemiah chapter 4, that's where we're going to kind of camp out this morning. We're going to look at three things that's involved in the work of the Lord that Nehemiah understood, that he helped the people of his day understand. And it's three things that we have to understand if we're going to have a faith that will stand and build the Lord's church and build our relationship with each other and build our relationship with the Lord. So notice with me a few things from Nehemiah chapter 4. The first thing, if you filled out your outline in the bulletin, the first thing that we see, if we're going to build like God's people should, number one, we've got to have a mind to work. We've got to have a mind to work. That's what it says in Nehemiah chapter 4 and verse 6. He says, so we built the wall, and the entire wall was joined together up to half its height, for the people had a mind to work. That's the first thing they had to do. That's what in chapter 2 he's telling them. I'm here to help you understand that your job is to work. You've got to have a mindset that we're going to do the work. It may not turn out the way we want. Things may not be exactly rosy like we want them to be. Everything might go in a different direction, perhaps. Who knows? But we know that it's not enough just to sit back and go, whew, and be comfortable. We've got to have a mind to work. When the people made up their mind they were going to do something, they worked, right? And undoubtedly, if you're someone who's been in a supervisory position, or if you're someone who's worked under people before, worked along with other folks, you know that in the workforce, there's those people out there that you give them a job to do, and they come back 30 minutes later and say, I can't do that. Right? We were setting monuments for a living, and there was a time that I had a boy working for me who was a big, strong, played football there at Dresden. He was, if he wasn't so short, he might have gotten to play college football. Big offensive line, bench press about a half a truck, could squat the rest of it, I think. And I'd give him a job to do, and 30 minutes later he'd say, I can't do that. And then I'd go over there and do it. And he'd say, I don't understand that. What? I'm way stronger than you are. I'm way younger than you are. He didn't have to say that. I couldn't do that, but you know what the difference was? For him, it was a job. He did his hours. He got a paycheck. For me, it was providing for my wife and children. I didn't have any choice about it. My mindset was, one way or the other, this job has to get done. That's what we've got. It's not enough just to be satisfied. It's not enough just to be in the right place and have the checklist and say, well, I'm sitting in the pew every time the doors are open. That's the way we far too often define faithfulness. I've gone through the checklist and I'm satisfied. We've got to have a mind to work. Make up our minds that there's work to do, and we know that, and we're going to get the job done no matter what. That's what the people in Nehemiah's day finally had to realize. Nehemiah helped them understand about this mindset. The mind to work in verse 6 is that decision that we're going to do the work. There's work to be done. It's not anybody else's job. It's my job. And I'm going to do what I'm supposed to do as hard as I can, as much as I can. Second thing in Nehemiah's day that they realized, they had to have a commitment to work. Jump down in Nehemiah chapter 4 to verse 15. And it says, and it happened when our enemies heard that it was known to us and that God had brought their plot to nothing, that all of us returned to the wall, everyone to his work. See what happens here in between verse 6 and verse 15, as the people are starting to work, those Samaritans and those people that lived around them said, what do they think they're doing over there? they think they're going to be mighty again. You know, we went for years where they were the big kids on the block, and they hadn't been for a while. They think they're not going to be able to do nothing. In fact, you can build your walls. You can't build a wall. They keep a fox out of you. And they saw all the oppression. They saw their armies come out and threaten them. They saw all the people that wanted to stop them from doing their work. And you know what they kept doing? They kept working. See, Nehemiah made them understand that you don't have to cower back. That's what they did for so long. Because God's on your side. And you've got to be committed to doing the work no matter what may go against you. No matter how you may think that things are going. That's the same kind of commitment we've got to have. We've got to make up our mind. We're going to work because it's my job. It's not anybody else's. I'm supposed to work. But then we've got to be committed. We've got to start the job, but then keep working and keep working and keep working. And never get to that point where we say, whew, see? Working on our relationship with the Lord. Working on our relationship with each other. Working on our relationship with our community. Working on evangelism, working on our giving, working on our leadership, working on our homes, working on all the aspects that God wants us to, committed to it. You know, I obeyed the gospel when I was a young man, a boy. And about the time that I obeyed the gospel, there was a grown man that obeyed the gospel at the same time at the Liberty Congregation where I grew up at. And he was a man that had a mind to work. I mean, he wanted to do whatever he could do. If there was a work day, he was going to be there. Have all his tools, do any job that you put him to doing. If there was a door knocking, he was going to be there. He'd have his tennis shoes on. He'd knock more doors than any three people put together. If it was leading singing, he was going to volunteer to lead singing. Absolutely the worst song leader you've ever heard in your entire life. But he was going to lead that singing. If somebody needed to fill in and preach, he was going to do it. You just think you've heard the worst preacher. Worst you've ever heard. Whatever it was, he was going to do it. Now, I'll be honest, didn't have a lot of talent, but he was committed to keeping on. And were there people that said, you really don't need to be leading singing because you're not too good at it? Probably. You know what he did? He kept leading singing. And were there people that said, you probably don't need to be preaching because you really don't know what you're doing? Probably. You know what he did? He kept preaching. And today, he's one of the best at preaching a sermon that you'll ever hear in your life. One of the best Bible school teachers I've ever got to hear teach a lesson. One of the best song leaders that I've ever had the pleasure of worshiping with. Says some of the most beautifully humble worded prayers you've ever heard. And he's an elder of the Lord's church. You know why? Because he was committed to working. No matter what went against him. No matter what anyone else might say. He was working on his relationship with the Lord and his relationship with others. See, we've got to have that same kind of, we've got to have that mind that we're going to work. And then we've got to have the commitment to keep on keeping on, no matter what. But there was a third thing that we notice from the days of Nehemiah in chapter 6. That is, Nehemiah understood that they had to have the right help to build. And this is my favorite one of all. And you've only got part of the passage up on the screen, but notice that part. In verse 16, half of my servants worked at construction while the other half held the spears, the shields, the bows, and wore armor. Verse 19, the work is great and extensive and we're separated. Verse 20, so rally to us. Our God will fight for us. So we labored in the work. Verse 21. You see, here's the problem. There's so much wall to be built. And one of Nehemiah's first things he said, you don't look at, and that's the way they did, boy, there's this big wall to build. Where do we even begin? We look at the relationships that we have. We look at the idea of evangelizing this county, this town, this community. And we say, where do we even begin? We look at our own lives and say, I don't even know where to start to get myself fixed, right? Where do we begin? So Nehemiah said, well, you just fix the wall that's right there at your house. Just right there in your, don't worry about the rest of it. You just work where you're at. You just do everything you can do right there where you're at. But then what happened is I'm here and they're over there and they're way over yonder. And out in front of me is this army. So Nehemiah said, here's what we're going to do. We're going to help each other. So while I'm working on the wall, Brian Foster is going to be standing beside me with a shield and a spear and a bow and an arrow and a sword. And Brian Foster is not doing any work on the wall. But is the wall getting built without him? Because I can't, right? And I know that over there on that side over there, Adam and Jason's over there. And if something happens over here, we're going to blow the horns. And guess who's going to be right here to help us? They're going to come running, right? Understand that Nehemiah is saying, you're not building this wall by yourself. We're all in this together. And we've got each other. And one of the things that destroys us, that keeps us from being who we should be, that keeps individually and as a group, is too many times we look at all this and we say, there's so much to do, where do I start? And we look at the amount of work that there is to be done and we're overwhelmed. And we have so many working against us and we say, I can't do this by myself. I don't even know how to fix my own life half the time. Yeah, wouldn't it be great? Wouldn't it be great if we lived in a community where if you were struggling with something, there were people there to help you? Wouldn't that be great? Wouldn't it? Now this is yes and this is no, and if you fall asleep, I start all over. I got to make sure you get this. Wouldn't that be great? You know, I don't know what you're dealing with, what you're struggling with, but if the statistics hold up, and I hope they don't, but if the statistics hold up, and we have about 300 people here, and say 100 of them are men, and 100 of them women, and 100 of them are kids, out of those 100 men, if the statistics hold up, there's somewhere between 25 and 50% that have struggled with pornography. Wouldn't it be great if we were in a community where if I'm struggling with pornography, I don't have to cower back and say I'm fighting this battle by myself and I can't handle it by myself, so I'm not going to do anything. But rather I could say, this is something I'm struggling with. And 10 or 15 or 20 men surround me and say, I understand. We're not going to gossip about you. We're not going to talk bad about you. We're not going to think less of you because we've done it ourselves. We've dealt with that and we overcame it. We're going to help you overcome it. Wouldn't it be great if we lived in a community where I don't feel like that we have to, you know, be one thing when we're at out in the public and another thing at home. And at home, man, I don't know what to do. I don't know how to deal with my kids. I'm trying the best I can. I'm praying and I'm working and they're making all these wrong decisions. I don't know if I could just admit that and say I'm struggling. I don't know which way to turn with handling these teenagers. I don't know how to keep our relationship together now that our children are moving off and going to college. If we didn't have to worry about people thinking less of us and talking about it, but rather they surround us and say, you know, we dealt with our kids going through that same issue. We can help you with that. You know, we had to deal with that when our kids went to college. We'll help you with that. Wouldn't it be great if we lived in a community where you didn't have to worry about being honest because you knew people were there to help you? Well, the truth is, that's what this community is supposed to be. God knew I couldn't do it on my own. And God knew you couldn't do it on your own. And that's why He put us together. You know, I love when you read in 1 Corinthians chapter 1 and Paul talks about that he planted and Apollos watered and God gave the increase. Paul said, I don't have to do it on my own. Apollos didn't have to do it on his, because we've got each other and ultimately we've got God to help us. And then later on in 1 Corinthians chapter 12 and also in Romans chapter 12, Paul talks about how that we in the church, we're a body. And not one part is any more important than any other part. We're all in this together. This life that we live is to be together. And we need to be willing to share with each other. And we need to be willing to help each other. And we need to be willing to, like the days of Nehemiah, if there's something going on, be able to holler and know we've got a bunch that's coming together to help us, to strengthen us, that has our back. That's what we want in the church. That's what we need in the church, is an understanding that we've got to have a faith that stands to build our relationship with each other if we're ever going to build our relationship with God and if we're ever going to build relationships to reach out into Paris and to Henry County and to Tennessee and into the world. That's what they had to understand in Nehemiah's day. And it's what we have to understand today as well. And you know, if we can start being honest with each other, if we can start reaching out to each other, if we can start encouraging each other and building each other up, our next problem will be, where do we add on to the building? Because of how much growth that we have. You know, when Lou Holtz got through that night, he didn't say a word till the very end. And you know what he said at the end of the night? You're dismissed. Go to your rooms. That was it. And the 24-point underdog Arkansas Razorbacks came out the next day in the Orange Bowl and destroyed the Oklahoma Sooners and their ideas of a championship. And Lou Holtz got carried off the field. Not because of his great speech. Not because he was the greatest orator. And I'm going to tell you right now, this church won't grow because you got the best speaker or the best preacher. They won because as a team, they came together and they appreciated each other and they helped each other and they leaned on each other and they said, together, separately we're weak, together we're stronger. That's what this church can do as well. And together, there's no way that Satan can defeat us with each other and with God. Now we're going to offer the invitation, and as we normally do, if there's someone here that needs to respond and come forward and publicly confess sin and make their lives right with the Lord, we hope you'll do that. If you're someone who needs to obey the gospel, as we talked about a few minutes ago, we hope that you'll do that. But what we want to do more than anything is we want to invite you today to let's start building those relationships. Let's start being honest. You know what I truly believe, and I'll be honest for a minute. I wish I'd thought of this because this is the kind of thing I love to think of, but I didn't think of this. Lana saw one of her friends that posted her husband, who's a preacher, did this, and she had more wisdom than Adam and I put together, but she at least forwarded it to us. And we've been talking about it all week, and we prayed about it all week, and we, in fact, met this morning in the office and prayed about it because what we're convinced is that there are people every assembly that we come together that know you need to do something. You're struggling with something. You don't know which way to turn. You don't have the answers. You're not sure where to even start. But walking up in front of everybody, that's kind of intimidating. If you can, I promise you, you'll be met with love. But at least write down these emails. Send an email to Adam. Send an email to me. We're inviting you to begin a conversation just between us. And let us help you. And let us show you that there are more that want to help you. Let's just start with just this one step of beginning the conversation. Of here's what I'm struggling with and how do I make it better. I know there's been times when I've sat in a pew and I thought I really need to come forward, but I don't know what to say. I don't know how to be received. I don't know what people will think. Just send an email. Whatever it is you're dealing with, there's a family here that loves you and we want to help you. And we'll just start right there. We're inviting you to stand with us. We're inviting you to have a faith to build. We're inviting you to understand that you're not in this life alone. You've got a God who loves you, and you've got a church family who wants to help you. Stand with us, and let's build while we stand and while we sing.